Hello everyone and welcome to this next video. In the last video we solved the aptitude questions of GATE 2018 examination in computer science. Now in this video we will be solving all the technical questions for GATE 2018 computer science examination. Initially we will be taking the total 1 mark question which is generally asked, which are approximately 25 questions, and then in the next video we will be taking the 2 marks question which are of a total of 30. So in this video it will be having all the 1 mark questions and this video might be very long. So let us start with the very first question here, and this very first question is from mathematics. And one more thing, if you want a PDF file of these solutions, then you can go to ankurgupta.net. Over there you will find the PDF file of these solutions. And if you want to take the courses for GATE computer science, then you can call us on WhatsApp us on the given contact numbers which is given below in this video. Also, don't forget to sign up at gatelectures.com. Now let us start with the first question here. It is saying, which one of the following is a closed form expression of the generating function of the sequence an, where an is equal to 2n plus 3 for all n is equal to 0, 1, 2 and so on. And they are giving us some options. That means we have to give a generating sequence or generating function for this an. And whatever the generating function, whatever the closed form expression that we are going to get from that generating function, we have to select that option. As I have very less space here, so let me take one more space, one more page or PPT page to solve the same question. Now what they are giving is an is equal to 2n plus 3. So you can write down this question on your notebooks also. So we have an is equal to 2n plus 3. This is something that is given. Okay. And they are saying it is valid for all n is equal to 0, n is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. Correct? Now, if we demonstrate a generating function gx, so we can say let gx be the generating function, or gn I can say here, because gn be the generating function, Now that gn for an, that gn function can be written as summation n is equal to 0 to infinity an xn. Okay, now guys, if you don't know how this generating function is created, then you can go back to my videos on engineering mathematics and discrete mathematics also. In discrete mathematics you will find the videos on generating functions. So here we have an which is given like this. We can just put this value of an in here. So we can say this generating function gn for this given an can be written something like this: in summation n is equal to 0 to infinity an is 2n plus 3 into x raised to power n. Now from here I can multiply x raised to power n over here, as well as I can also multiply x raised to power n over here. So this function gn, now it can be written something like this: summation n is equal to 0 to infinity, we can have 2n multiplied by xn, x raised to power n, plus summation n is equal to 0 to infinity, we can have 3 multiplied by x raised to power n, and this is what we can do very easily, right? Now I can take all the constants out. For example, here this 2 is a constant, I can take it here. And here this 3 is a constant, I can take it here. I just want to take all the constants out because the summation is dependent on n, right? So I can also write the same expression something like this: 2 into summation n is equal to 0 to infinity, we'll be having n into x raised to power n, plus 3 into summation n is equal to 0 to infinity, we'll be having x raised to power n. Now guys, you can see this entire formula is generally in the form of this formula, this part I can say it is a capital A, and this part I can say it is a capital B. Why I'm saying? Because that will be more convenient and easy to calculate, because I can just evaluate the value of A separately, I can just evaluate the value of B separately, I can put those values here and I can get the solution. So this same generating function can also be written as 2A plus 3b. Okay, this is the generating function that we have, and we just have to insert or substitute the values of a and b. Now let us try to solve the values of A. Okay. So we have A, which is equal to summation n is equal to 0 to infinity n into x raised to power n. Now if you are going to expand this, take some time and put the values of n over here, value of n here as well as value of n here. If you are just expand this, then we will get 0 into x raised to power 0 plus 1 into x raised to power 1 plus 2 into x raised to power 2 plus 3 into x raised to power 3 up to so on till infinity. So this can also be written as 0 plus x raised to power 1 plus 2x raised to power 2 plus 3x raised to power 3 plus up to so on till infinity. Now what can you say about this sequence? Now guys, this sequence is a combination of both arithmetic progression as well as geometric progression, because of x is increasing geometrically, that is in the powers exponentially, and this 1, 2, 3, it is increasing arithmetically. That is why it is a combination of both arithmetic, geometric progression. So it is called as AGP, or can say arithmetic geometric progression, where the first term is 0. Here you can say the first term here is equal to 0, and the common difference between every sequence, common difference in every sequence, that is 1, and the ratio that we have is x. Okay, because in every sequence we are multiplying by x. Now this is a sum of infinite arithmetic geometric progression. So if I say what is the sum of infinite arithmetic geometric progression, you can just check back in your books, you can just take back some your 11th or 12th standard books, then you can easily find it out. It will be the first term upon 1 minus r plus dr upon 1 minus r whole square, where when I'm saying r means it is the ratio, a means the first term, and d means the common difference. Okay, just substitute these values and you'll get capital A, the value of A will be 0 upon 1 minus x, because the first term is 0, plus x upon 1 minus x whole square, because the common difference here is also 1. So this value of A can be written as x upon 1 minus x whole square. So we know the value of A now. Now second step is to find the value of B. B can be written as summation n is equal to 0 to infinity x raised to power n. And if you expand this, because n is from 0 to infinity, so it can be written as x raised to power 0 plus x raised to power 1 plus x raised to power 2 up to so on till infinity, which can be written as 1 upon x. Correct? Now this time, you have the value of B, you have the value of A. Now take the same formula here and substitute the values of B and A, then you get the value of generating function. Now for this particular generating function, the value of A is x upon 1 minus x whole square plus the value of B. The value of B here is 1 upon 1 minus x, that can be written as 2x upon 1 minus x whole square plus 3 upon 1 minus x, like this. Now solve this equation, take 1 minus x square as the LCM, so we'll be having 1 minus x square here. So in numerator we'll be having 2x plus 3 minus 3x, because this will be multiplied with here, with this situation. So we'll be getting 3 minus x, because we have 3 minus 3x and 2x here, so it will be 3 minus x divided by 1 minus x whole square. Okay. And if I just check it out, can I match it with any options here? You can see the first option is not matching. The second option is not matching. The third option is also not matching, but the option number D is matching. D is the correct answer for this question. But guys, just make sure that this question is not at all tricky. They are just asking you whether you know what is the generating function or not. And if you know what is the generating function, then you can easily solve these questions in the question in the examination hall, right? Now let us look at the next question, which is a question number 2, and it is a C programming question which is using structures, and we'll be having pointers, and we'll be having the printf statement, and they're asking what is the output of this program. let us check out this program. We'll be having a structure, and every structure will be having three characters. When I'm having a structure which is called as our node, it will be having x, y, and z. These three locations are the character variables. Now, in the first case, we'll be having struct our node p, which is having the value 10A+2. Now, make sure here we have A+2, where capital A is a character and 2 is an integer number. Now, when I have this A+2, that means I'm just incrementing in the ASCII values. Guys, here this will be incrementation of the ASCII values of the character. So, this P, if I demonstrate the above structure here, if I demonstrate this one as P, the name of this one as P, in the first location we'll be having 1, in the second location we'll be having 0, but the third location, because we have A+2 and the ASCII value of A is 97, then I'll be having 97+2, which is 99, and 99 is the ASCII value of C, so we'll be having small c. So this is small c, this is actually not capital T, it is a small c character. Okay, now we know what is the value stored in this variable, which is 1, 0 and c, all are in character variables. Then we'll be having a struct our node star q is equal to %p. That means there's a pointer q which is just pointing to this variable. Now when I'm trying to print these values here, we'll be printing these values as a percentage c. So assuming that the address of this variable is 1000, now we'll be having the first statement is character star q plus 1. We'll be having character star q plus 1. Now this q is having 1000, but because of the character star, when I'm having 1000 plus 1, that is going to make it 1001. Why 1001? Because we are telling that this is a character variable, character pointer. Now just increment by character, so that means just increment this pointer by one location. This is called as a typecasting. Go back to my computer C programming videos, then you will understand what is a typecasting in case of C language. Generally, typecasting for the pointers is having a little bit tricky. It's not very tricky, but it's a little bit tricky. Now we are typecasting this pointer to a character pointer, because initially it was an our node type of pointer. Now we typecasted it to a character pointer. Now when I increment a character pointer by 1, because generally pointers are incremented by their scalar values. So when I increment this character pointer by 1, it will just increment to one next location, which will be 1001. And here in 1001, we'll be having, this is the location 1001, we are storing the character 0. Now, because of this star, we are printing this value of location 1001, which is 0. So the first value that will be printed by this here will be 0. Now let us check out the next value. Again, the same way, I'm doing the same incrementation here. Here it is 1000, but when I'm saying 1000 plus 2, that will be 1002, because we typecasted it to a character pointer. At the location 1002, we have the value which is C. And trust me guys, this is so easy. It's so easy to calculate the free marks that you can get in your examination hall. And this C will be printed, which is a small c. Okay. So the output of this given program will be character 0 as well as will be character C. So these two are the characters. Correct. So it will be printing 0 and C, both in the form of character. Correct. I hope that you understood the program. Now, there's a question here whether we are going to print option A here or we are going to print option D here. Now, guys, you can check in this printf statement, nowhere we have used single inverted commas. Between option A and option D, the examiner wanted you to confuse that even if you find out the answer, then you may choose to mark option number D because it is percentage C, that is a character, you are printing a character value. But when the output will be printed, it will only be printing 0, C. So option A is the correct answer. Don't confuse the answer to be with option number D. Right? I hope that you understood this program. It's so easy, guys. Let us look at the next program. It is related to the Q, which is implementing a single linked list. A queue is implemented using a non-circular single linked list. Okay. So this is non-circular. The Q has a head pointer and a tail pointer. You understand what is a Q, right? So in case of a Q, if this is a Q, now whenever you insert a data that is inserted from the bank, that means NQ operation can be done like this, but a DQ operation can be done like this. Okay, now this can be head of the Q and this can be the tail of the Q. Now they are saying that we are implementing Q using a non-circular singly linked list. Q has a head pointer and tail pointer. Head pointer is pointing to the very first node. This is the first node of the Q. And tail pointer is pointing to the very last node. This is the last node of the Q. Now, let N denote the number of nodes in the Q. N is the number of nodes. And let NQ be implemented by inserting a new node. That means whenever you are inserting a new node in the Q, that can be done by the NQ operation. And DQ can be implemented by deletion of a node from the tail. Deletion of a node from the tail. Remember guys, here DQ operation, they are not deleting from the tail, but rather they're not deleting from the head, but rather they are deleting from the tail. And NQ operation is inserting a node at the head. At the first location, you are inserting the node. Then that is called as an NQ operation. Guys, this is also a very simple question, but you just know how to implement these operations. Let me implement the NQ operation first, and then I'm also going to tell you how to implement the DQ operation. Let me take one more slide to represent the NQ and DQ operation here. So, as they said, the NQ operation here, that means inserting a node at the head. Okay, so it is insert a node at head of the queue. Okay, and second one is DQ operation here, that means deletion of a node from the tail of the queue. Deletion of a node from the tail of the queue. Deletion of the node from tail of the queue. Okay, now this is the queue. Okay, and we have a head pointer here and we have a tail pointer here. I'm assuming that we have a struct node which is having integer data, and we'll be having struct node star next, which is pointing to the pointer. So this is the next pointer and this is the data part. So every node is having two parts, that is the data part and the next part. When I'm saying NQ, that means insert at the head. So for that, I'm just writing this function, which is NQ function. It is taking node star head as the input, and we have the integer data, or let us say we just take node star new node as the input. So we have a new node as the input as well as we have a head as input. NQ means here we have a new node. Make this new node point to the first node. So I'm just going to make new node, new, next, the next part of the new node, make it point to the first node, which is pointed by head. So this will store the address of this first node because this address is stored by head. And then make head point to this new node. So head will now point to this new node. This is so simple, the two line code. Okay. So we created a very simple function which takes the head of a node linked list as an input. It takes the new node as the input and it adds the new node into the queue. And then in the last, it just return the address of head. So we are not using any recursive program as well as we are not using any loops here. Now, just because we are not using any recursive program and loops, that is why this function will take order of one as the time complexity, because it's a very simple function and we just have to implement these three statements, and these statements will take constant time to execute. Correct? Now, when I have to do deletion of a node from the tail, deletion of a node from the tail. For that we have to write a DQ function. Now DQ function can just take the linked list as an input, or I can just make this head as a global variable to be available to every function. Now in the deletion, if this is the linked list, I have to make tail point to this node, correct? So I have to take one more temporary variable so that I can make tail point to the temporary variable. I can make tail point to the first node. But the problem here is that we don't have an address of this node because this is a singly linked list. It is not a doubly linked list. So at least we have to run a loop so that we can get the address of this node, address of the second last node. How will you get the address of the second last node? We have to find it out. Let us take a temporary variable, that is node star temp, which we may will make to point to the head. That means we'll make a temporary variable which will point to the this node. Let me change the color of the pen. So we'll make a temporary variable which will point to this node. Now we have to make this temporary variable to reach to the second last node. So for that I'm just going to write a loop which is while temporary variable, the next part and the next part is not equal to null. Okay, what does it mean? That means if temporary variable will point to this, now this is the next part and whatever this next part. So next part of the next part, this next part should not null. If this next part will become null, then temporary variable will stop at this location. Unless we reach to this condition, we'll make temporary variable to point to the next node. Okay, you can refer to my data structure videos if you have checked on my channel how I'm writing this program, because it's so easy one, right? And then I can make temporary variable to point the next node, the temporary variable to point to the null. Okay, because after the end of this while loop, the temporary variable will be pointing to the second last node. And because it will be pointing to the second last node, so I can make the second next point of second last node to be null. I just made the second this pointer to be null. And I'm going to make this tail point to this temporary variable, and I can change the location of tail. Instead of pointing to this location, it can just point to this node here. Okay, and this deallocation of the memory of the last node, you can do it here. You can just free up the memory for the last node. You can write a simple line, but I think for understanding this program that is not required here. We just have to make it as simple as possible. But you can clearly see, if we have a total of n elements here, if you have a linked list with the n elements, in worst case, this DQ operation, we have to go to the second last node, and this while loop will run completely, and this will take order of n as the time complexity. Therefore, NQ operation will take order of 1 as the time complexity, and DQ operation will take order of n as the time complexity. Now coming back to this program, the option number A is wrong because here NQ is taking order of 1, theta of 1, and DQ is also taking theta of 1, which is wrong. Option number B is a correct answer because NQ is taking order of 1 and DQ is taking theta of n, which is correct. Option number C is wrong because NQ is taking order of 1, so it is they are reversing this. And option number D is also wrong. So only the correct option is option number B. And I hope that you understood this program and this question easily. Now let us move on to the next question here, and this next question is from the digital logic part, and obviously it's again digital logic questions which are generally very very easy. Now here we have two operators. This is denoting X OR operator and this is denoting X NOR operator, which is a very, you know, this is a very commonly used terminologies for X OR and X NOR operator. And they are asking which of the following is not correct. Which of the following is not correct? Now check out the option number A. Option number A is perfectly correct. Why it is correct? Because XNOR, how you make XNOR? If this is the XOR operator, if this is the XOR operator, now generally the XNOR operator is generally created just by using a NOT gate after this. That means XOR operator, if it represents X P XOR Q, XNOR operation can be represented by P XOR Q whole complement, or it can also be represented by P XNOR Q. You can solve it, right? But why to waste time in solving this equation, because even a school child can solve this. So this is correct. Check out the next one. Next we have P complement XOR Q can be written as P XNOR Q. Let us check this one out. When I'm writing P XOR Q means P complement Q plus P Q complement. Okay. Now when I'm saying P complement here, so everywhere here I have to replace P by P complement. So this expression can be written like something like this: P complement complement Q plus P complement Q complement, which can be written as P Q plus P complement Q complement, which is denoting P XNOR Q. Correct? Which is also correct. Therefore, option number B is also correct. Check out option number C. In option number C, we have P complement XOR Q complement. In the same expression, just put these values, then we'll be having P complement complement Q complement plus P complement Q complement complement, that can be written as P Q complement plus P complement Q, which is again representing P XOR Q, the same operation. Hence, option number C is also correct. Now check out the option number D here. So option number D is saying, when I'm having P XOR P complement XOR Q, can I write it as P XNOR P complement XNOR Q complement? Okay. So there's a properties of complementation, which is a very interesting property for XOR and XNOR operation. If we have P and Q, this is denoting P XOR Q and this is denoting P XNOR Q. So the values can be false, 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 true, true, false, and true, true. When I'm saying P XOR Q, in case of XOR, this is true, true. Okay. So in case of XOR, it is false when both of them are same, but it is true otherwise. Okay. But in case of XNOR, it is true when both of them are same and it is false otherwise. Right. Now, if P is true, then P complement is false. If P is true, then P complement is false. Take the first statement. When we have P XOR P complement, that means if it is true, it is false. So this value will be true. So it will be denoting 1. Okay. So this statement here, it can be written as 1 XOR Q. Correct. And the second statement, when we talk about the XNOR operation. Now XNOR is false when any one of them is false. So this is denoting false. So it will be 0 XNOR Q complement. 0 XNOR Q complement. The first one is 1 XNOR Q. And second one is 0 XNOR Q complement. Okay. Now here, this statement, when I'm saying 1 XOR Q, if Q is false, then this statement will be true. If Q is true, then this statement will be false. Okay. So this statement will be actually equivalent to Q complement. Okay. And when we discuss about this statement, it will be, if Q is true, then Q complement will make it 0. So it will be true. It will be true when Q is true. And it will be false when Q is false. Let us check it out. If the value of Q is true, that is 1. So 1 complement will be 0. So 0 XNOR 0 is true. When the value of Q is 0 and 0 complement is 1, so 1 XNOR Q is 1 XNOR 0 is going to be false. Now this particular statement will be equivalent to Q only, because if Q is true, then this is true. If Q is false, then this is false. So this particular statement, it is actually representing Q complement. And this particular line, it is actually representing only Q, which is not equal. Hence, option number D is not correct. And they're asking which of the following is not correct. Just read this statement properly, because generally students do this mistakes that they do not read the question properly. They just get confused that every option is correct, then which one is wrong, or every option is correct, then what should I choose, right? So they make very silly mistakes just by not reading this option here. Personally, I have this experience that many times when I practiced the previous year GATE question and even the actual GATE examination, I just my mind just forgot, or you can say it skipped the word not. And that is why I, even though I solved the question correctly on my notebook, but I failed to mark the correct answer in the actual examination hall. Okay. I hope that you understood this one. So answer is option number D for this. Let us look at the next question, which is saying, consider the following processor design characteristics. Now, the characteristics are like this. Register to register arithmetic operations only. That processor is having register to register arithmetic operations only. Next, fixed length instructions format. Okay. The third one is hardwired control unit. Fine. Now, which of the characteristics above are used in the design of a RISC processor? Which of the characteristics above are used to design a RISC processor? Okay. Now, what are the properties of a RISC processor? When I'm saying we have a RISC processor, RISC. What is RISC? It is reduced instruction set architecture. Now, in case of reduced instruction set architecture, the instruction length cannot vary. Instruction length cannot vary because we have already having very few instructions. When we have CISC, CISC means complex instruction set architecture, in that case we'll be having many instructions, which can be short instructions, which can be long instructions. That means the length of the instructions can vary in that case, but instruction length cannot vary in case of RISC processor, and it's usually 32 bit as the length. Okay, and in case of CISC processors, length will be equal to 16 to 64 bits. The length will be equal to 16 to 64 bits. Now let us check out the next characteristics of the RISC processor. So in case of CISC processors, we can have 16 to 64 bit instructions. This is actually general case, but totally depends on your implementation. But as you know that CISC processors are having complex instruction sets, that is why the instructions that we are going to use in that CISC processors, they can be of varied size. Okay, and one more thing about the RISC processor is that mostly the RISC processors are only using register to register arithmetic operations. So register to registers operations. Okay, so RISC processors does not contain register to memory or memory to register, memory to memory operations, because they become more complex. So when we have CISC processors, they contain register to register, as well as they can have memory to memory operations only, memory to memory operations also. So RISC processors can have only register to register, but it cannot have memory operations. But CISC can have register to register, memory to memory, or any operations including the memory as well as registers. Okay, and generally this register to register arithmetic operations only, they are only possible in the RISC processors. Second, fixed length instructions are possible in the RISC processor. And third one is hardwired control unit. Now this hardwired control unit is used only when we have instructions are fixed, when instruction size are fixed. Okay, as well as instructions are fixed, I can say. Instead of saying instruction size, because instruction size should not be a correct thing here. It is only used when the instructions are fixed. That means the number of instructions that we can have, they are fixed. We cannot increase or decrease the number of instructions also, because that include the rewiring of the entire circuit. So when I'm saying which of the characteristics above are used in the design of RISC processors, that is all the three characteristics, that is 1, 2 and 3, all these three characteristics are used in the case of RISC processors. Okay.